when I did, whatever, when I finally did make a 900, I'll never forget that just a couple days later, I emailed Neversoft because we were on the final beta version of the game. Like it was being submitted to Sony. Mm-hmm. You know, you cannot change it once that happens. Like you send it to the console people. That's it. That's, you're locked into that version. And they're about to send it. And I was like, hey, do you think you could put 900 as a trick in there? And I'll never forget, Joel, who was the head of Neversoft, sent me a reply just like, already on it, you fucking rule.
Sick. Because that kind of would have been a bad move if that game came out without the 900.
Well,
not a bad move, but you know what I'm saying, though.
Well, we didn't know at the time, but when we got into the sequel, we could have put it in there. But for sure, that was
still like, you had done it, the game's coming out, like, what, the 900's not in here?
Yeah, and that, you know, the whole conspiracy that somehow this is my master plan in life is not even close to truth. It was all a perfect storm, and I feel very lucky happened. Yeah. You know what I mean? But I mean, all that stuff was in the works and going to happen with or without me doing a trick.
How much you make off that Tony Hawk game? How much they pay you, huh? What are we talking about?
Still getting checks?
All right, I'll tell you this. When the fourth game was released, this is just, I'm not going to, like, I don't want to go into great detail of this, but I will give you this.
Okay.
When the fourth game was released, my main contact at Activision asked to have lunch with me in LA when I was there one day. And he's like, yeah, he's not the head, but he was definitely the guy overseeing our games.
Okay.
And he's like, here's what's happening. We're releasing the fourth game. The last three are still in the top 10 of sales. One is going into, I forgot what they call it. It's like classics mode, which means they sell at a certain price, but way more volume.
Oh,
he's like, so things are way bigger than you ever thought. And he handed me a check for $4 million.
Oh,
that happened.
Wow.
That was just for meeting with you that day.
Well, it was my, you know, whatever it was. I don't remember, annual royalty or whatever it was, but I was just like, what?
What do you do with that?
I could tell when he was saying it, it was like,
leading up to something.
This is big. Like, this is bigger than you imagine. And I'm just like, cool, I might get $1 million. Like, that's amazing.
This might.
And then he hands me, and then he just slides his check over, and I was like, I got lunch.
Yeah. Don't worry, I got the. What do you do? You like run to Bank of America and put in the ATM? Like, what do you do? Like, how do you, what do you do with that? Like, how do you deposit?
Yeah. I think I immediately
put in the ATM.
Yeah, that's what I said. No. Yeah. Like, what are you going to do?
I might have, actually.
Yeah.
I might have put in the ATM because I was always on the
zero,
go.
I'm not zero, kidding.
I was
zero,
always on the zero, go back then. Zero. So I was just like, all right, here we
deposit.
Go. But no, I don't want to downplay that. That was, it changed my life. Like, the video game changed my life. Wow. Changed everything, my sense of awareness, my opportunities. It allowed me to stop competing and do things that I always dreamed of, like the Huck Jam, stuff like that. But in that moment, it was definitely overwhelming. I think I immediately put in, I'm pretty sure I put in about $200,000 or $300,000 into the foundation.
Oh, that's amazing. Yes.
Because I was like, all right, because I can't, you know what I mean? Yeah. I'm walking the walk. Like, I want a good portion of this to go to skate parks. Like, I felt very strongly about that. And I wasn't doing it. I never did it for press. You know what I mean? Like, and especially with all those appearances and stuff, you have, here I am trying to brag about it. So take what you will with that. But, but I never, you know, I was never doing press. Like, I just never liked trying to draw that kind of attention. Always felt forced to, like, if you go visit Make-A-Wish Kids and you have a camera tag along, like, no, that's, it means you're not really in the moment.
Yeah. For sure.
You're not doing it for the most healthy purposes. You're doing it because you were trying to get
publicity,
the press. Yeah, right. The publicity. Absolutely. Yeah. The best thing about our foundation is that we have literally concrete proof of our work.
Yeah. Like,
you donated money. Proof. You donated money. Here is a skate park.
Yeah.
Go watch these kids skate.
Well, if the opportunity ever comes up, we'd love to do a 9 Club Tony Hawk park.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Wait, but what, like, awesome. Just a little while ago, you were asking me for funding for your show.
That's separate.
And now
that's separate.
Does it just come full circle? I give you the money and you give it to the skate park?
Yeah, there we go.
That works.
Yeah. Little 9 Club.
We could bring back the Venice graffiti pits, dude.
Oh, yeah.
That would be tight.
Get a shovel.
Isn't it up right now? Like, that art exhibit?
It's an art. Yeah, it is an art exhibit.
Beyond the streets.
It's not, yeah.
How crazy is that? Like, that's how far skateboarding's come, is that little segment of the world that just was the dirty skaters.
Oh yeah,
in Venice.
Oh yeah,
where homeless guys were like shooting up and everything.
Yeah, taking shits.
But
yeah.
But it's this iconic place that was had genuine progressive skating happening. Yeah. Is now an art exhibit.
Yeah.
Like, that's how far we've come. It's amazing.
Totally.
It's unbelievable. Wow. Like, stuff like that blows me away still to this day. Like,
have you ever thought about that too? Like, in the Tony Hawk Foundation, maybe building like plazas? You know, like not necessarily like skate park vibe, but like more of like the graffiti pits or like
there are a few projects that we've definitely supported.
Okay,
you
cool.
Know? I mean, among those 588 or so.
Yeah.
There are a few that are more along those lines.
Okay, cool.
And we're also working with, there's a group, the Ralph Seawood Foundation in Michigan. That's mm-hmm. kind of what they want to do is more nice. Sort of art spaces that are skatable.
Yeah.
So, but like I said, I can't take the credit for that. Like the crew that we have at the mm-hmm. foundation is a well-oiled machine, and I just have to shake hands and kiss babies.
I love it though, man.
And
I mean,
show up with the ribbon cuttings.
Yeah, like, yeah. Do you carry those big scissors with you on the plane, or do you?
I've only done that a couple times. I've actually only done that a couple times. Because I don't, and but, I know that, like, and even our foundation, like, we know that we've empowered someone else to do a lot of the groundwork, mm-hmm. so we don't like taking credit for that. And I think that's
amazing.
Our model of how we do skate parks is that where we're not just going, all right, here's a small town like Fargo, North Dakota, they need a skate park. We're going to come in and build a skate park and we get the glory. We want the communities to have a sense of pride and ownership in the project that they helped to create.
Yes.
That they were having fundraisers for, that they were petitioning for and going to city council meetings. We just give them the tools to make that happen.
You just help facilitate the build and
because otherwise like happen. They won't even take care of the place.
That's true.
If it's just given to them.
Yeah. I like that.
Right. So, that's our model.
Love it.
That's my pitch.
Yeah.
So now I want the money. Now I want the money to build the nightclub skate park.
But Tony Hawk's pro skater and all that stuff. You guys did like what, 18 or something? Like it's
across all the platforms.
I mean, imagine, you know, 4 million. Must have made a lot of money.
Yes. But,
you know, I was very surprised too, Tony. You didn't ask me to be a character in any of them. You know, so it was very.
I think it was a little. It was.
You were still amateur. They only had pros.
Yeah.
In there.
Yeah.
Only had pros.
That must have been it.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
It got tricky. tricky to reinvent the wheel every time too. You know, and then once EA Skate came out and it was a whole different control scheme.
Right.
That split the market.
Totally.
And then, you know, we both had a good run, but I think both companies were like, we're fighting for a smaller piece of the pie. And it's just not,
yeah.
I mean, that's why it's not happening.
I don't know. Because like, I feel like nowadays too, like people want EA Skate back. They want these back. Like, I feel like there is like something, you know, like you could
there
maybe
is,
do
yeah.
something for,
Twitch,
do something for that.
I'm working with a phone app. Developer on
phone
something.
Apps are great.
Oh, wow.
They're great, but yeah. I mean, like the video.
No,
games
I know what you're saying, but I'm just saying, like, I'm pretty excited because
that's
I feel
amazing.
Like this one is on the right track.
Okay, yeah,
and I'm in. So, but I can't exactly say what it is yet. So,
okay, yeah,
you'll know when it happens. I'll be promoting it.
Yeah, okay.
Sure,
well, I'll know good, when you ask me to be a character.
Yeah.
We'll know
but I would, know yeah, I mean, I would love to do another console game. You know, it's just that my contract ran out with Activision,
mm-hmm.
and so they can't make a Tony Hawk's Pro Skater.
Gotcha.
I can't go with someone else and make a Tony Hawk's Pro Skater.
Oh, right. And they have no. They don't want to do one. I feel like
not
there's
at
a
the
market
moment,
right
it's,
now.
You
for
know,
that.
It's video games are so tricky. Like the market got so diluted.
Yeah, it's true.
And it just became shoot 'em ups,
mm-hmm.
yep.
mm-hmm.
and first person shooters, Fortnite, Call of Duty.
Yeah,
yep. You know, and then that was it. That was the monster, and it was like,
right.
Unless you're Madden, you're not. No sports games are really going to infiltrate that.